fate song of Florida let a little sunshine in your heart. Although, when I landed this afternoon, there wasn't any. It looked pretty miserable, but we've got this storm going through right now. And I know all of you here have gone through with Irma some terrifying experiences. When Irma was striking Florida, we were on a cruise ship in the Caribbean. And we couldn't go, a few days after, we couldn't go to where we wanted to go where we were told we were going, because of Maria coming. And so we went a completely different direction. That wasn't on the script, by the way, but I just wanted to give time for them to get down. And again, wow, accompany us there. Wonderful combination. Thank you, Clearwater Songsters. That's a first for me to hear you sing live. So that's great. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Rail travel began in England when inventor Robert Stephenson designed and built a steam locomotive in 1829. Over the next century, the UK established rail travel as a vital means of transportation. Towns and villages across the land were connected by steel rails. And soon after the Second World War, the concept of people commuting from the countryside into a town or city for work became popular. Nearly every community had a railway station run by a station master. I want to tell you about John Smith. John Smith had been the station master at a little town in the east of England for many years. His station was immaculate. He tended to the flower beds. He made sure the platforms were swept. But more importantly than that, he treated each of his passengers like family, addressing them by name each morning, greeting them as they returned home as the train trucked into his little station. Everyone who caught the train from that station felt special and didn't look on their commute as arduous, but rather it was just like family. In fact, many would say, without John Smith, life would be dull. Such was his passion for his responsibilities, plus his dedication of ensuring everyone felt included. So imagine when word got out that the newly nationalized railway system meant that this little station and the line to the city was to close. That news was closely followed with the announcement from John Smith that he was going to retire from the railways. "We must throw a celebration for John," said one passenger. "Hey, we could involve the entire village," said another. "But wait," said a third, "we must keep it a surprise." That was easy. John Smith lived alone. The date and time was set for the last day of train travel to and from that village, and John Smith's last day as the station master. No one had mentioned anything as they said goodnight to John on that last day as they left the station. He was a little surprised by that reaction after all these years. But he thought, well, maybe the fact that they've been grateful for what I've done for them is enough. That evening, great excitement was felt across the village as people darted to and fro, decorating tables, preparing food, even the brass band was rehearsing. And an air of excitement built to bursting point as everyone became involved in the celebrations as a tribute to John Smith's dedication and his decades of service to the railway and his passengers. So at an agreed time, everyone became silent. The lights were switched off to make it a real surprise for John Smith. This was going to be such a wonderful celebration of a white life well lived. Speeches had been rehearsed, praising him for his interest and love, flowers and gifts purchased as a sign for our affirmation for his unwavering care and interest in his passengers. So imagine this, the crowd had gathered, the lights were off, in silence. As the agreed time came and went, it was not easy to maintain complete silence. And that soon became 5 minutes, and already whispers were heard, giggles from the children, someone knocked over a chair in the darkness. The silence soon turned into a babble of conversation, and even some anger crept into the conversation. "I wonder if he's okay," said one. "Well, he was at the station when I arrived home. He looked okay to me." "We spent all this time preparing, and he hasn't even the decency to show up." "Well, I think it's a disgrace. Perhaps we made a mistake. Perhaps he's not the person we thought he was, standing us up like this. And to think we've gone to all this trouble. Just not worth it." Someone needed to take action at that moment, as the crowd had started to turn into an angry mob. What they thought was their friend of all these years had let them down. So the mayor, sensing the tension, called everyone to order. "This is so unlike John," he said. Everyone nodded in agreement. Well, who was responsible for ensuring that John came to the village hall? It was like a schoolroom when the principal said that the culprit needs to own up. No one moved. Everyone began looking at each other, pointing fingers and asking, "Was it you? Was it you?" The truth was, they'd become so involved in the event that no one had invited John to meet them at that time. Galatians says, "I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." How many times can we be involved in the event, in the routine, in the things that happen, and we forget to invite our Lord and Savior into that gathering? I pray that we will always be mindful that John Smith, Jesus Christ, is our Savior and friend and needs to be invited for all that he has done for us.